Thank you so much for clicking on this video. I am Brooke Makenna, but today we are going to be talking about the Willingham family and what really happened to their three little girls. Now, this family made up of the father, Cameron, who was 23, the mother, Stacy, who was 20, and their three girls, Amber, who was 3, and Carmen and Cameron, who were twin baby girls. Now, at the time, they were living in Corsicana, Texas, about 55 miles away from Waco, Texas. And the mother was working at her brother's bar while the father, Cameron, was staying home with the kids. Now, the day of the awful tragedy that happened to this family was December 23rd of 1991. And this day, their mother, Stacy, was out buying Christmas presents for the three girls while their dad stayed at home and watched them. But unfortunately, that morning that the mother left would be the last morning that she would see her three little girls. Now, normally this is where I like to go into a backstory about the victims and kind of give you more of a insight into the kind of person they were, but unfortunately these girls were too small to really get to have a story or get to show the world their personality like they should have been able to. So unfortunately, all we know is that they were three beautiful little girls who didn't get the life that they deserved. So now let's get into what happened. Now, on this day, a little girl, a little 11-year-old girl named Buffy Barbie, was a neighbor of the Willinghams and was outside playing in her backyard when she started to see smoke and fire coming from their house. So she ran inside to tell her mom, and they decided to run down the street to see what was happening. Now, once they got there, they saw the father, Cameron Todd Willingham, standing outside of the burning house saying, "My babies are burning up." Now, he had a blackened chest from the soot, he had singed hair, and all he was wearing was pants and no shoes. Now, he noticed the Buffies and he yelled at them to call 911, so the mother ran back to the house to call 911 and get help, and her daughter stayed there. Now, what her daughter had said and a few other neighbors said, that at this time he tried to go back inside the house. He knocked out the window that was in the front that led to the children's bedroom, but flames came out at him. So he went to the next window he could find, broke it in, but flames did the same thing and he could not get in the window or the door. So at this point he walked out to the front lawn and just sat down. Basically, what a neighbor said, it looked like he was giving up or trying to block the situation out of his mind. And at this point, he put his hands over his face, he kneeled on the grass, and he just started screaming, "My babies, my babies, my babies," over and over again. Now, a little while later, the fire department did show up and he started getting hysterical again. He showed them where the children's bedroom was and said that he couldn't get to them, and was kind of wrestling them to get into the house once they started using the hose with water in it. And actually, police chaplain George Monaghan, he had to hold him back along with another officer from going into the burning house. And it was forceful enough, Cameron was being forceful enough, that he actually gave George a black eye that day. But when he got him calmed down enough, he kind of took him to the back of the fire truck. It was kind of just calming him down and talking to him. And that is when they carried the body of the two-year-old Amber out of the house. At this point, she was not breathing and they were performing CPR on her. Now, right before this, Cameron was talking to George and saying that Amber is the one that woke him up. His little daughter was the one that came into the bedroom and told him, "Daddy, Daddy, there's a fire." And he sprung up at that moment and got out. But he said that it was too late for Amber. He couldn't hear her anymore. The smoke was coming in way too fast. He couldn't see, and Amber was nowhere to be found. That he screamed at her and said, "Get out, Amber, get out," but he couldn't see where she was. He didn't know what had happened. Then he said he went to the the baby's bedroom and crawled around in there. But when he was crawling around in there, he only felt a doll and couldn't feel them. So he had to go outside to catch his breath. And that's when the flames got even worse. Now at this point, all three of the children were out of the house, but not conscious, and were taken to the hospital, where Cameron Todd followed, and he was there told that they had all passed away from smoke inhalation. Now the twins, Carmen and Cameron, were found lying in the children's bedroom where they were supposed to be, but Amber was found in the master bedroom, confirming Cameron's story that she was the one that came in and told him. Now as part of the investigation, they decided to look into it further and make sure it wasn't an arson, and the police chief, Douglas Fogg, went in. He had 20 years of experience, and he said that you learn that fires talk to you. So he was looking around, and that's when he decided to bring in Manuel Vasquez, who was an arson specialist, to get a second opinion. So 4 days after the fire, they went in to search, to gather notes and photographs and get any possible evidence, and they noticed a refrigerator, the second one, blocking the back door, the back entrance, the back exit. It was pushed up against the door, and where a counter was, it made a very small area to be able to walk through. Basically, you had to suck in and squeeze to get past this area. It seemed a little strange, but they moved on from there. Now, while searching, they found a few other strange things, one of them being a wall of skull pictures in a utility room. But again, they kept moving forward. They moved to the master bedroom. But while looking there, they determined that the damage in the master bedroom was done from smoke and heat, and so it couldn't have been where the fire originally started. So they walked down the hall and started picking up debris and just kind of investigating down the hall, and that's when they found something. They noticed that the charring on the wall was very low, which was very unusual, and that there were poor patterns along the floor and a burn trailer, which basically is when a flammable or combustible liquid accelerant is poured on the floor. And this was their first kind of sign, they said, that it was arson. When they finally got to the children's bedroom, they noticed that the deepest burns were on the floor and that it was much hotter than the ceiling, which basically meant that something was off, because normally heat rises, and this time it didn't. There were brown stains and soot marks in the shape of a V in three places, which basically means that the fire had started in three different places. That was in the children's bedroom, the corridor, and by the front door. Now, this was all Vasquez and Fogg needed to say that this fire was intentionally set by human hands, and the father, Cameron, was now the prime suspect. Now, they took samples of burned materials by the front door to test for a liquid accelerant, and they sent that out to the lab. And while they were doing that, Cameron asked to go back to his home, and he was allowed to go with the firemen. And there he was kind of looking for any belongings that could still be usable, and he seemed very saddened, is what the fireman said, and disturbed that his dart set was not anywhere to be seen. And another strange thing is that they put on a fundraiser, the town did, at the local bar to raise money for their funerals, and apparently all he could think about at that time was his dart set, and he said that money wasn't a problem now, so he was going to buy himself a new one. But then again, that is all speculation, and we have no idea if that is true. Now, while waiting for the samples, the investigators began interviewing more witnesses. And at first, the witnesses and people around town were saying that they didn't believe he would do this, that he was a great guy who loved his kids. And slowly but surely, once they caught news that it could possibly be arson, the witnesses and the people around town began coming forward with stories and saying that they did believe he could do this, that he wasn't a good guy. And so the evidence against Cameron began to add up. And that is when the samples came back. Now, the samples that were tested by the lab chemist were from around the front door area, and they came back positive for having signs of liquid accelerant or mineral spirits, which can be found in charcoal lighter fluid. So 8 days later, he was brought in for questioning, where he told the exact same story that he had originally told to police George Monaghan. Now, he completely said that he was innocent, that he could not have done this, and he believed that it was either started from the space heater that was in the girl's bedroom that Amber liked to play with a lot, and even though she had got whoopings a lot for doing it, she continued to do it because she was a two-year-old, or he thought it could have just been electrical problems. So he basically didn't see how they were coming up with the fact that it was arson. He was very adamant that he did not do this. Now, when asked if he thought that anyone had a motive to hurt his family and to be the ones to do the arson, he said this quote, "He didn't know no one that cold-blooded. I just don't understand why anyone would take them. We had three of the most pretty babies anybody could ask for. Me and Stacy have been together for 4 years, but on and off. We get into a fight and split up. I think those babies is what brought us closer together. Neither of us could live without the kids. To tell you the honest to God truth, I wish Amber hadn't woken me up." Now, the final question Vasquez asked was the one that ultimately led to his arrest. And this was, "Were you wearing shoes when you left the house?" And Cameron said no, that he didn't have enough time, he ran out. And Vasquez said, "Well, that's it. There was no black soot on the bottom of his feet, which would have had to have happened if he had ran out in this fire, so he was guilty. Because the only other way he could have gotten out with nothing on his feet, as the reports show, he would have had to be the one to set the fire and run out as he was doing it." So now, although they had absolutely no motive as to why he would want to kill his children, and his own wife was saying that there was no way that he would kill them, he was still taken to trial. And even the life insurance policies were looked into, and they only totaled up to $15,000, and that money would go to Stacy's grandfather because he was the one that paid for them. So at this point, they still have no reason as to why he would do it, but they believe he did. So he was taken to trial. Now, while he was arrested, inmate Johnny Webb came forward with a message saying that those two were in jail together and that he had confessed to him, saying that he squirted lighter fluid all over the floor and killed the children. He agreed to testify against Cameron, and Cameron, who could not afford lawyers, was assigned to by the state. Just before the trial, he was offered a plea deal where he could escape the death penalty in exchange for a guilty confession and a life sentence in prison. He said no way, and his parents were even brought into it to say, you know, you need to talk him into it. This is the only way he's not going to die. And the parents went to him, and he still said to them, "I ain't gonna plead to something I didn't do, especially killing my own children." And so the trial began. Now, this was in August now of the next year, and on the stand to testify was Johnny Webb, the inmate, and the mother of the Barbie family, who was the one to call 911 that day. They both told their stories about that they believed he was guilty and why, and that was only some of the evidence that they had to bring forward against him. But the other evidence consisted of picking apart Cameron's tattoo of a skull and a serpent that he had tattooed on his arm, and saying that that was basically means for him being a psychopath because he had this tattoo. Now, a psychologist was brought in to interpret posters that Cameron had, which was an Iron Maiden poster and a Led Zeppelin poster. Now, these were apparently very, like, violent pictures and posters, and so they were interpreted as very dark matter, and that they were an indicator of cultive-like activities, and basically further confirmed that he was a psychopath or a sociopath. Then they began to bring up Cameron's past, where he was abandoned as a baby by his mother and got into some minor crimes and criminal charges as a teen. Now, these were things like driving under the influence and stealing, but psychiatrist James Grigson came forward and said that the past criminal charges that he had had before meant that he was a complete sociopath and was completely incurable. Now, this man was called Dr. Death because he was brought in anytime they needed to get an inmate to get the death penalty. Manuel Vasquez went on the stand and said there was more than 20 indicators of arson. And the only witness that Cameron brought forward was his babysitter, and she said that there was no way she believed that he was the one to kill his children. But he did not go on the stand, and it is speculated that his own lawyer said to not do it, so he didn't. So that was it. Now it was time for the jury to come up with their decision. It only took them an hour, barely an hour, to sentence him to death row. Now, he sent many, many, many appeals, and they kept being denied over and over again while he was awaiting his death in jail. But one day, he began writing with a woman named Elizabeth Gilbert, and they became pen pals. Now, this was after his divorce with Stacy. She continued to say that he was innocent, but they just couldn't do it anymore as a married couple, so she filed for divorce, and Cameron was feeling very lonely, had no one to talk to, nobody came and visited him, so he had asked Elizabeth to come in and see him. Now, Elizabeth Gilbert was a 47-year-old divorced woman who had a friend that worked with opposing the death penalty and asked her if she would be willing to write to an inmate on death row, and she said why not. She was lonely as well, so she ended up getting a letter. She gave them her name and her address, and she ended up getting a letter from Cameron. Now, this letter said, "If you wish to write back, I would be honored to correspond with you," and then asked if she could come in and see him, and she decided to do it. The first thing he told her was that after the divorce and being in there so long, he really had no one to remind him that he was a human being and not some monster like the state professes he is. She visited him often after a while, saying that he was a very nice, polite man, and completely the opposite of what she figured that he would be, being an inmate on death row. And they began talking about things like art and her writing. She was a playwright, and he even voiced to her one day that he was afraid that she would see him as a one-dimensional character because, being in prison, his social graces had pretty much gone down the drain. Now, he didn't really want to talk to Elizabeth about the case or what happened because he said he's reminded of it every day in that place, and she was kind of an escape for him, so they didn't talk about it much. But the more Elizabeth got to know this man, she became more and more curious about the trial and what actually happened to make him get on death row. So she went to the courthouse, got all of the trial evidence, and began to read through it, where she found a lot of strange things and things that pointed to an unfair trial. She found multiple accounts of witnesses that had originally said he was a great guy who was just trying to get to his children that day to know he absolutely did it. He killed his children after the word arson was being thrown around, basically, that as soon as they heard that he could have possibly done it, their story switched. So she made it her mission to track down the people involved with the case. Some of them still believed he was guilty, including the Barbies, but quite a few of them wanted to change their story now and believed there was no way that he did this and deserved to be on death row. Now, one of the people she came in contact with was Polly Gooden, which was his probation officer when he was younger. Now, she said that Cameron never showed any bizarre or sociopathic behavior, that he was a very polite kid who did stupid, dumb kid stuff, and that the things he stole weren't even significant things. Now, she even got to sit down with Stacy, Cameron's ex-wife, the mother of the three past children, and she still to that day believed that he was innocent, saying that she believed that Amber could have been the one to do it, because she had often put things close to the space heater, and no matter how many times they warned her about it, she was a 2-year-old girl who did it anyway, and so she was afraid that maybe Amber had done it. Upon further research, she found that the psychiatrist, James Grigson, who said that he was an incurable sociopath, was actually in trouble at the moment. He had used those same exact words with a man who was about to be executed, and 72 hours before his execution date, he was completely found innocent with new evidence, and so basically his theory of this man was completely wrong. And 3 years after Cameron's trial, he was expelled from the American Psychiatric Association for violating ethics. And then she found Johnny Webb, the inmate that had come forward about Cameron, and he was back in jail. So she went to see him, and he had told her the same exact story he told on the stand, but he did say that before the trial, he was diagnosed with post-traumatic stress disorder and that he was found mentally impaired. Strangely enough, several months after Elizabeth visited him, he sent a testimony to Cameron's lawyer to recant the statement, saying Mr. Willingham is completely innocent of all charges. But unfortunately, Cameron's lawyer was never told that this was sent, and Webb recanted it before they could even use it. Now, after yet another denied appeal for Cameron's case, Elizabeth found the name of a guy of Gerald Hurst. Now, he was an acclaimed scientist at the time and a fire investigator. She took a chance with him and sent him a file of all of the arson evidence in the case in hopes that he would see it. At the time she sent it, Cameron did not have much time. His death date was approaching, and if he was innocent of this crime, there was only a small amount of time to prove it. So in January of 2004, another fire investigator was finally brought in to do more research on the case. And Gerald Hurst saw this from 1991 and was instantly intrigued, because he said at this time, basically, investigators took arson as a flat earth theory. So basically, if it looked like arson, it was. So he was instantly intrigued and worried that possibly a man was about to be killed and executed for no reason. Vasquez had wrote that out of the 1,200 fires he investigated, most of all of them were arson. And he knew right there that something was strange, because that is a very high percentage of arson rates. And the more he searched, the more he was finding Cameron innocent. So he was very quickly searching through this material, knowing that his execution date was very, very close. Now, instantly, the chemical testing that they did was rebutted by Hurst, saying that they found charcoal lighter fluid by the front porch. And he looked at pictures, and there was a grill right next to the front door where they took the samples, and it could have very easily been from that. Now, the brown stains that they had said had not yet soaked into the concrete and were signs of accelerant being poured were tested by Hurst. Now, in his own garage, he poured lighter fluids on the floor and set it on fire, and when the fire went out, there was no brown stains, only piles of soot. The biggest thing to prove that he was innocent was basically the poor patterns, the burn trailer, and the V shapes on the walls. And he instantly thought of the fire, of the Lime Street fire, that was very, very similar to this case. They had the same evidence on that man as they did on Cameron, and he was about to be executed when they decided to recreate the fire in a building that was about to be torn down. So this house was set on fire using no liquid accelerant, and basically it showed that flashover, which is when a fire in a room becomes a room on fire, does the same thing with the pore patterns and the burn trailer and the V shapes. It can do the same exact thing as if liquid accelerant was poured on the floor. And the only way to test this is to take samples from the actual pore patterns or burn trailer on the floor, which in the Willingham's case, they did not do. Now, Hurst immediately knew that he 100% believed that Cameron Willingham was innocent of arson and killing his children. And he typed up the report so fast he didn't care about typos. He sent it to the governor and he sent it to the Board of Paroles and Pardons. Unfortunately, neither responded to his appeals at all. And at this time, Stacy went to see Cameron for one last time and changed her story completely after that visit, saying that she believed he was completely guilty and that he deserved to be executed, basically, which was a complete surprise to Cameron, and he was devastated. Now, nearly a month later, on February 17th, 2004, Cameron Todd Willingham was executed by lethal injection at 36 years old. Now, unfortunately, prior to his execution date, Elizabeth Gilbert, the one who had been helping him all this time, got into a severe car accident, was paralyzed from the neck down, and could not be there to say her goodbyes. Just before his execution, he had confessed to his parents that he was completely innocent of killing his children, but he did lie about something that day, and that was the fact that he didn't go into the children's bedroom to check on them. But he didn't want anyone to think that he was a coward for not going back in and getting out instead. He told his crying mother that day, "Don't be sad, in 55 minutes, I'm a free man. I get to go home to my kids." After his death, while Elizabeth was doing physical therapy to get better, she had been quoted saying, "At this time, I thought I was saving Willingham, and I realized that then he was saving me, giving me the strength to get through this accident." Now, 2 years later, three top fire investigators came together on a panel and concluded that he was completely innocent, and that each and every indicator of arson was scientifically proven to be invalid. Now, Cameron had final words on that day he was executed. "The only statement I want to make is that I am an innocent man convicted of a crime I did not commit. I have been persecuted for 12 years for something I did not do. From God's dust I came, and to dust I will return. So the earth shall become my throne." Those were his last words, and that's where this case kind of stops. Except for that, now that this has become even more talked about, because there is scientific evidence behind the fact that there was a good possibility he was innocent and executed anyway. The laws on the death penalty in Texas are really being looked into and pushed, and people are protesting them. So let's get into some of the theories in this case and kind of what I think about it. And yeah, you guys can leave me down below what you think as well, but these are some of the theories that people think. When I was looking into this case, I kind of thought of this theory that Johnny Webb could have been given a lesser sentence for a false testimony, basically. He was very, not slow, but he was definitely mentally impaired, and that would make him an easy target to be manipulated into anything that they wanted him to do. And there is even paper trails showing that the judge in this case helped him a lot to get out, to get on parole, and just helped him a lot after this trial. His testimony actually was basically that Cameron had completely confessed to them and told them the exact area that it happened in, and basically this area in the jail would be right next to a speaker where the guards could listen in, and if Cameron was saying he was innocent the whole time, you would think that he would be more careful with where he was saying things, who he was saying them to, if he was trying to maintain this like innocent act. The thing I found was strange was that Cameron said he poured some kind of liquid, and I feel like if you planned murder of your children, you would know. You know, if you can be that malicious and that wrong in the head to kill your own children, you would have every detail perfectly, and you would know what lighter fluid you used. You wouldn't just, especially if you were bragging about it to somebody else, I feel like, you know, the typical bragging way would be to go into detail or something. And maybe I'm wrong, correct me if I am down below, but that just seems a little odd to me that he would say it that way. And actually, I was watching a new interview after I was doing research, and Johnny Webb has now come forward with a confession saying that he was told to say what he testified. So that kind of proves that theory if he's telling the truth. Now, the second theory is that Amber did do it, and I hate blaming a victim. I think that that's so horrible, and none of these three beautiful, amazing little girls deserve to die. But you have to wonder if maybe Amber did accidentally put something in the space heater and it started a fire, and that's why she ran to her daddy's room saying, daddy, like help me, I've done something wrong, you know, trying to tell her daddy because she had done it. I just think that it is a possibility. I just feel like if you believe in a heaven, and if little Amber was up there looking down at her dad in jail, she would not have wanted him to go through that if she was the one who did it, if you believe in stuff like that. But you just never know. Kids do things that are accidents all the time that land them in big trouble, little trouble. You never know. Kids are curious creatures. So, yeah, let's move on to the next theory. So, my third theory is that Vasquez and the entire town and the investigators all kind of had a very fixed thought about who did it, what happened, and they didn't want anything else to cloud their judgment. They wanted it to be arson, and therefore it was. Actually, there's a quote by a psychiatrist that says, "The mind is not a passive machine. Once you believe something, it changes the way you perceive information and the way your memory recalls it," which could absolutely be what happened in this case if he was completely innocent. No, it could just be because that's what they believed for so long, that's what they were told for so long. Or it could be that they have an inkling that I didn't read about and I didn't see through my research. Number four is that Cameron did kill his children, and that maybe the evidence of the arson that they're now saying he's innocent on was, it was way back when Vasquez didn't do his job, but he just said it was arson, so now Hearst doesn't have enough information to really say it wasn't. I don't think that I really believe that one though. I think that there was quite a lot of information that Vasquez reported and quite a lot of it that Hearst rebutted. So, and a lot of people in the town say that his strange actions after the fire told more than anything else, that he was very distant and didn't really talk about the kids or grieve much. But correct me if I'm wrong, but everyone deals with trauma and with death differently and with grieving, and I don't know if that's necessarily something we can hold against someone or could hold up, you know, as far as thinking they're guilty, because I think each and every one of us deal with things so differently that you never know. I mean, he may have just been distant because he was trying to avoid the amount of pain and guilt he felt for, you know, not being able to rescue the kids. But on the other hand, I guess it could have been the guilt he felt for killing his kids, but I just don't know. There's something in my gut that's telling me that he didn't do it, and that it was kind of a very tragic accident that three little girls lost their lives in, and then a dad was executed when he was an innocent man and had to live the rest of his life grieving for his daughters, and also, you know, being accused of their murder, which would be the absolute worst thing ever. I mean, can you imagine yourself in his shoes? If you think, okay, say he was an innocent man, that's what you believe. Put yourself in those shoes of going to jail for the murder of your children that you already feel guilty about because you couldn't save them, and now you have to defend yourself because you didn't do this and everyone else is saying you did. How awful would that be? I can't imagine. But those are all the theories, and all I want to say that is that either way, if he was guilty, if he was innocent, this story is about the three little girls that lost their lives far too soon, who didn't get to live out their life story like they should have been able to. And I just hope that this brings awareness to this case and that we become better at being less about speculation and more about hard evidence and really looking into it. I mean, he tried to appeal many, many times, many years later, when better investigators would have been able to look into this like Hearst, but unfortunately nobody wanted to give him that chance because he was already on death row, and so it didn't matter if there was new investigators that could have proven his innocence before Hearst. They weren't going to give it to him, so I think stuff like that needs to be changed. It doesn't mean that every single time they're going to be innocent and going to be let out, because if investigators look into it again, they could be just as guilty as before. But I'm not saying that all people on death row, all inmates, are deserving of a second chance. I'm just saying that we really need to fact check and make sure and kind of give ourselves and like the justice system, the investigators, they need a second chance to make sure they did everything correct, if that makes sense, because there are a lot of things that can change. A lot of testimonies that can be faked, like we've seen with Johnny Webb. I mean, this whole thing would be very different if James Grigson, the psychiatrist, was already expelled. If Johnny had said, no, I'm not doing the testimony, a lot of things would be changed and he probably wouldn't have been executed. But I'm glad to see that people are standing up about this case and trying to get the death penalty changed a little bit in Texas. Now, I didn't read too much into that, but I will leave some links down below if you want to read about changing the laws in Texas. And I guess let me know down below what you think, what your theories are, if you agreed with any of mine. If you didn't, that's completely fine. Just please be very nice in the comments below. I don't mean to offend anybody in this family, in this town, anybody involved with this case. But yeah, please let me know down below, and please just remember these little girls and share their story as much as you can, because they only had a small amount of life to live, and their father didn't get much of a life either if he was innocent. So yeah, please give this a thumbs up if you would like more of these kind of videos. If you have anyone that you want me to talk about or any cases you want me to do, leave them down below and make sure to subscribe for more. I'm trying to post every Friday for Freaky Friday. Please always let the darkness of the world fuel the light in you, because that's what keeps the darkness of the world at bay. And I think that that's all. So thank you for listening to this case and hearing the Willingham story. Yeah.